Good morning.
It is the first day of the week, the Lord's Day, and so I am so grateful that you are gathered here to worship Him on His day. And what a beautiful day it is that He has given for us. And we are excited indeed because it is Friends and Family Day. And so we want to say again, especially to our guests, we're honored to have you with us. We hope that you find here that we truly love our God and are seeking to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And we hope that you'll take the time to get to know us after the service, especially as we go downstairs and share that meal together. We've prepared it with you in mind. If you got your Bibles and you want to open up in just a few moments, we're going to be reading from Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22. We're continuing our series in the book of Daniel. And we've come last week to the events concerning Daniel and the lion's den, as it has been called. And we began that last week, and today in the Bible class, we concluded our thoughts on those events. And perhaps because this is, for most of us, a very familiar account, we may take some of the events for granted. Especially, we may take for granted the fact that Daniel is going to survive his time in the lion's den. But if we were reading this for the first time, we would not know whether or not, in fact, he would survive being placed into that den of lions because of his faith. So I want to think about that for a moment. You know, not too long ago, there was an event at the Cincinnati Zoo. A toddler crawled under the barrier to the gorilla enclosure and fell into the moat. And a male gorilla named Harambe took notice of this child. And he went over to the child and he began to interact with the toddler in a way that made the park officials very uncomfortable. So that ultimately they decided for the protection of the child to take the gorilla's life. Now, after these events took place, there was a video that was circulating in the news media and on the internet where you could see what was happening. And as a child fell into that enclosure, and you saw that humongous gorilla batting him around like a ball, it made you really uncomfortable. It was a tightness in your chest, fearing for the life of this child. That's the kind of fear that I can imagine we would feel if we were viewing the events described in Daniel chapter 6 in real time. This older gentleman in excess of 80 years being lowered into a pit full of angry lions. How nervous, how afraid that would make us for his life. And that raises an interesting question, doesn't it? When Daniel was placed into that den of lions, he did not know if he would survive. What if today were the last day of our lives? What would really matter to us if we knew that today would be the last day of our life? Perhaps what would be on our mind would be the future of our family. Protecting them, making sure that they were prepared to go on without us, making sure that they had the financial and physical resources they needed to continue without us. That might be what was going through our mind if we knew that today were our last day. Or perhaps we would be thinking about the legacy that we would leave behind. Who are the people that I've influenced in my life, and how will I be remembered? I think it would only be natural if those were the kinds of thoughts that went through our mind if we knew that today were the last day. But I'd like to suggest this morning that what we find in Matthew chapter 22 establishes a standard, one that we ought to think about when considering that we will not live forever on this earth. Matthew chapter 22, We find that a lawyer, as he has been called, comes to Jesus and asks him a question. Beginning in verse 34, this is what we read. But when the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, what is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. If today were the last day of our lives, what would really matter? I'd like to suggest from what Jesus has said here, three things would really matter. Our love for God, our love for our neighbors, and our love for ourselves. First of all, our love for God. Our love for God. We must know God to love Him. Have you ever misjudged someone? Have you ever met someone and made a first impression about that person? And having met them and made that first impression, for one reason or another, you did not like them? And that judgment call that you made on that first encounter guided the way that you interacted with that person in future events. I've done that before, and that's been done to me before. But you know, experience has taught me to do better, because I have in fact misjudged some people, thinking that for one reason or another that they were unworthy in some kind of way, and coming to find that in fact I was wrong. You see, it's hard. It's hard to treat someone the way you ought to if you don't know them. And that is most certainly true of our God. A number of different things have been said about the God of the Bible, a lot of them wrong, and a lot of them ungracious. But I think more often than not, they come from ignorance. Because I believe once we come to know the God of the Bible, we can't help but love Him. And He has, in fact, revealed Himself to us. He's revealed Himself to us in a number of different ways, and that's what the author of Hebrews says as he opens his sermon that we call the book of Hebrews. He says, long ago at many times and in many ways God spoke to our fathers through the prophets, but in these last days He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed the heir of all things and through whom He also created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of His nature, and He upholds the universe by the word of His power. After making purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. It's through Jesus Christ and the prophets, the things recorded in this book, that we come to know God. We should not expect that we could love God if we don't first know Him. That simply does not make sense. But also, we cannot love God unless we are brought near. We must be brought near to God in order to love Him. In Isaiah chapter 59 and verse 2, Isaiah tells the people that their sins have made a separation between them and their God, and that because of their iniquities, God has hid His face from them. See, sin is a destructive force. It is a force that always breaks down relationships. And that's true in the relationships that we have with one another, and it's true in the relationship that we have with God. But here's the catch. Because God is perfect, and He is righteous, and He is holy, even a little bit of sin is enough to separate us from Him. And so how can we be brought near to God? How can we love God from afar? He has made a way for us. He's made a way for us to be brought near to Him through His Son, Jesus the Christ. And so this is what Paul writes in Colossians 1, beginning in verse 15, about Jesus. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Verse 17, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. And verse 20, through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. Our sin separates us from God, but we can be brought near. We can be brought near through the blood of Jesus Christ that he shed on the cross for your sins and mine. He paid the price that we could not pay, so that we could be brought near to our God and so that we could love him. Because of the sacrifice that Jesus Christ made on the cross, you and I are able to call God our Father. We are able to be born again into the family of God when we believe that Jesus, in fact, is the Christ, the promised one of the Old Testament who died for our sins. And because of that belief, we turn away from our life of sin. We confess his name and we're buried in the waters of baptism. We're brought near. We call God Father. We want to love God. We must be brought near to him. Third of all, we must obey him. Jesus makes this abundantly clear in John chapter 14. As we noted last week in the sermon, in John chapter 14, Jesus is preparing his disciples for the fact that he is going to be tried by the Romans, that he's going to die on the cross, and that they are going to have to go on without him. And in John chapter 14 and verse 21, he makes this statement, "Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me." Did you catch that? Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. And my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me." Jesus makes it abundantly clear that we must obey God in order to love him. When we make that statement, sometimes people say, "Well, that sounds awfully legalistic. That sounds like work salvation. That sounds like an overemphasis on law over love." But we didn't make the statement. Jesus did. And if we take just a moment to think about it, it really does make sense. Think about a child who never obeys his parents, constantly rebelling. Do you think that father and mother feel love coming from their child through that constant rebellion? How do we think, with God being a much more perfect Father than any of us could ever be, that we're going to be pleasing to him, that we're communicating love to him when we refuse to submit to him and his word? Forgive me, I grew up in a household of country music. And so I'm going to share an illustration that is a little bit dated and reflects on that culture of my upbringing. But I always think about this song when we talk about obedience and loving God. It's a song by Clint Black called "Something That We Do." And there's a part of that song that says, "Love is patient, love is kind. Love is yours and love is mine. But it isn't something that we find, it's something that we do." We must obey God to love him. If today were the last day, how would you feel about the way that you have loved God in your life. If today were the last day, how would you feel about the way that you've loved your neighbors in this life? In a parallel passage in Luke chapter 10 to Matthew 22, we find once again that Jesus answers the question that was asked, posed by the lawyer. But we find a little bit extra in this chapter as the lawyer seeks to justify himself by asking Jesus to define the neighbor. So we begin reading in Luke 10 and verse 25, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? How do you read it?' And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' Verse 28, 'And he said to him, You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live.' But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?' Jesus replied, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, "Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay when I come back." Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." In order to love our neighbors, we must recognize their human needs. Their human needs. The priest and the Levite passed by. They saw the man in his distress, and they pretended as though he was not there. They ignored the fact that another human being was on the brink of death. We must recognize that every person around us is a human created in the image of God. That they need the same compassion that you and I need. That at times they will need physical help and spiritual help as well. But I want to notice the original question that the lawyer asked in verse 29. "Who is my neighbor?" And compare that to the question that Jesus asked in verse 36. "Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor?" The lawyer was saying, "Who do I have to serve? Who is my neighbor?" And Jesus says, "Don't worry about who your neighbor is. You be a neighbor to everyone." You be a neighbor to everyone. To love our neighbors, we must recognize their human needs. We must also recognize their physical needs. In the book of James, James addresses believers, and he addresses them in such a way as to help them grow continually in their faith. And so he talks about a number of different issues, one of which is that of partiality. Those he addresses have a problem. They are making value judgments about others based upon their appearance. When the rich man comes into their assembly, they give him the seat of honor. When the poor man comes into the assembly, they put him in the corner, as it were. And so James addresses this problem. And he says, in beginning in verse 14 of James chapter 2, "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or a sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says, 'Go in peace, be warmed and filled,' without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead." We read this and we think, well, that's not me. I've never said to someone, go in peace, be warmed and filled. But how often do we see someone in need and we say, I'm praying for you, and it never goes beyond that? It's certainly right that we pray for those in need. But if our faith never leads to action, we are not loving our neighbor. Now, of course, the response comes up. Well, there are so many people in need, and oftentimes it's hard to know who genuinely needs my help. And I simply can't help everyone. And it's true that we cannot help everyone, but every one of us can help someone. And every one of us probably knows at least one who is genuinely in need. I think that would be a great place to start. We must recognize the physical needs of our neighbors if we're going to love them. We also must recognize their spiritual needs. All of us go to school and to work and to play with people who are separated from God because of their sin. Is it loving for us to pretend that somehow they will come to God without anyone telling them about Jesus Christ? It is not love that pretends that sin does not separate us from God. It is love that gently warns others about what is to come. In Galatians chapter 6, beginning in verse 1, Paul writes, "Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." You know, there's an old hymn. I don't think it's in the book that we have here, but the title of that hymn is, "You Never Mentioned Him to Me." None of us wants to stand on the day of judgment and to see our neighbor, to see our coworker, to see our classmate, to see our golf buddy hear the words from Jesus Christ, "Depart from me, I never knew you," because we failed to tell them about our Savior. To love our neighbor, we must recognize their human needs, their physical needs, and their spiritual needs. If today were the last day, would we be satisfied with the way that we've loved God, with the way that we've loved our neighbor, with the way that we've loved ourselves? That might sound a little bit odd, but what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 22 is to love your neighbor as yourself. Something there is implied, that to some degree we must love ourselves. The greatest thing that any one of us can do for ourselves is to prepare for eternity. Paul writes the letter to the church at Philippi while he is awaiting trial in front of the Roman government. He's appealed to Caesar as a citizen of Rome, and so he's going to be tried by some high official, and there are a few possible outcomes. He could be acquitted. He could be exiled. He could be executed. And in the midst of that situation, he makes this bold statement of faith to the believers in Philippi. "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." How is it that Paul is able to say that to die is gain? Perhaps because he knows that he is prepared for eternity. We do ourselves a great disservice if we pretend that we will not one day stand before God in judgment. So to love ourselves, we must first prepare for eternity. Second of all, if we want to love others, we cannot hate ourselves. We cannot love others well if we hate ourselves. In Luke chapter 6 and verse 31, Jesus gives what has often been called the golden rule. He says, as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. Now within that statement, there is the thought, of course, that you are treating yourself well. Because certainly Jesus is not advocating the mistreatment of others. Now this only makes sense. Think about it. The Father, who constantly questions whether or not he is good enough, whether or not he is capable of leading his family, of whether or not he is able to set the right example for his children. Through that constant questioning, he not only does a disservice to himself, but he does a disservice to his children. Think about the wife who despises herself so much that she rejects the love of her husband and her children. You cannot love others well if you hate yourself. Misery loves company. And the most miserable people are usually those who don't like themselves. And so, Jesus tells us, you got to love yourself. But there's a big difference between being a lover of self and loving yourself. 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul writes about the end of time. He says, but understand this, that in the last days there will come times of difficulty. For people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness but denying its power. Avoid such people. The lover of self thinks only of self. But the person who loves himself is able to love others, God and his neighbor. If today were the last day of your life, how would you feel about the way that you have loved God, about the way that you've loved your neighbor, about the way that you've loved yourself? Would your life hold up to the standard that Jesus establishes in Matthew chapter 22? Is there something in your life, some unresolved issue that you have with a neighbor or with God, that is keeping you from loving as you know you should? Is there some issue that you have with yourself that is keeping you from loving others as you know you should? The fact is, we are not promised tomorrow. And regardless of whether or not today is the last day, it may very well be. And we will answer for this day and for everyone that follows it. But we have the opportunity, because of Jesus Christ, to stand confidently when we answer, to call God our Father, and to know that because of Jesus Christ, we've been able to love as we should. And if you are lacking that confidence today, He invites you. He invites you through Jesus Christ to become a child of God, to be able to say that you can love as you should. Or if you're already a child of God, to return to the God who loves you and who gave His only Son for your sins. So whatever your need may be, you're invited this morning as we stand and sing together.